Here last night, Charlene, my wife, and myself, till, you know, almost, it was late in the evening, and they was working, and she's like, you know, Pastor Promise said, I'm not going to have the children's building, I mean, the classroom ready. Can I take off? I'm like, oh, you're killing me, you know. You're killing me. And, but, you know, it was for a reason, because it's a process. God had placed something on our heart to do, which absolutely, that I didn't talk to her about, it just lines up to what he's doing right now. So the process in which God is building the pieces in your house is going to be, you know, being prepared and built in the kids' house as well, in their lives. So they're going to be learning the same thing you guys are learning, you know, which is really good, which is most important. I want to share a few things with you, because, you know, a lot of confirmation has been coming down the road. And I want to start off by saying, first, God has been talking to us about the lampstand in, a major way, okay? And this goes back to the first time I had talked about it, but it was Charlene had asked me. She said, "Do you have any, you know, anything against changing a lighthouse to a lampstand?" Well, that was just a confirmation in my spirit, you know, with the sign that's going to go up there. I'm like, absolutely not. In fact, the church was called the lampstand. So then the next thing I know, I get invited to go to meet this guy, Norwood Seymour, and he's talking about this lampstand, and we get to go see it, and I showed you guys the picture of it and all of this kind of stuff. And, you know, and the lampstand and what it represents is about the imparting of the Holy Spirit, okay? There's a lot of things, and we're going to get into it, but a lot of things between last week and this week has happened. And I'm going to tell you what, because God is fixing, is preparing His church for, you know, a big move, an outpouring of His Spirit, and you're going to see it in a minute, how it all just falls into line and into place. But here it is. You guys know, I go meet Seymour and all that, and he's building this lampstand, and the words the Lord had spoke to me, and all of this stuff. And you know, Monday, it was Monday, you know, that you know, I went to the hospital to go pick up Brother Joe. It's good to see him back, you know, glad to have him back. He's been going through some stuff. But Monday morning, I felt in my spirit I needed to go to the hospital to see Brother Joe. And this is really going to make, I mean, a major tie-in. So my wife and I get up and we go into into Slidell. And while we're in Slidell, we call up Madge, and Madge was, "Yeah, we are leaving today. We was going to call you. We're going to need a ride home." I said, "Well, we right here. We'll come over there." You know, and so I want to connect a few dots with you really fast, how amazing God is, that, you know, I go by this man, Brother Seymour's house. You know, he says 25 years ago he had built the furniture pieces, and he's talking about the lampstand, and, you know, the lampstand is in Exodus 37, and I'm sitting there listening to, hearing this. It's 25:37, right? 25:37. And you know me with numbers and God and how He speaks through them and stuff like this. And so I go visit Joe and I walk up to his room number. His room number is 25:37.
Wow.
I mean, you know, is it by any coincidence, you know? Not only that, you know, Joe, you know, when I go in there, the lady comes in there to take him out. And when she pulls up there, she pulls up with wheelchair number 25. You know, I'm like, so anyway, long story short, we get in the car, I'm taking Joe home. And you remember the message I told you about Brother Seymour? I just felt like there was an impartation that he was trying to impart his spirit into Paul. Remember that?
Yeah.
But it was, God told me to write everything down. I wrote all of those notes, Well, little did I know, it was for me. It was for Paul, but I'm praying about it. I actually got my wife praying about something, and my mom, we held hands and prayed together. And this is when it clicked, when I was in a call with Brother Joe. Check this out. Anybody knows Brother Joe? Brother Joe absolutely loves Schaubhut.
Amen.
All Joe talks about is Schaubhut. And he tells me all the time, I know, brother, I'm always talking about Schaubhut. You know, but there's just something about it, you know, just something God done. And that brother Schaubhut and the faith and the miracles. And Joe is talking about faith, miracles, and Schaubhut and the importance of giving and blessed are those who give, if they just knew it and all of this stuff. And he takes that from the Queen of Sheba. And look, if you know Joe like I know Joe.
Yeah.
So anyway. So remember, God is constantly speaking to us. It's whether you can see it or not. So we get in a car and we're going down the road. And Joe tells me as we're going down the road, you know, the strangest thing. He said, you know, before I came here to the hospital, I found my old wallet from over 20 years ago. Right? So now, you know, he's kind of got my attention. I'm going down the road, he said, and you know what was in that wallet? A $50 bill.
Wow.
He said, that Schaubhut gave me. You know, and right then, I mean, the Lord just hit me. 50 is the number of the Holy Spirit. When we moved here, I talked about how Earnest next door means earnest, or a deposit. Duval means dove, or the spirit. A earnest deposit of the spirit. I gave him a deposit on the building. It was God's leading to what he was doing. To give us this house, he's building a place. But this is all over, and I'm going to show you how this works. Then he says, you know, that he had given me $50 and I just found the wallet. Is that right, Joe? You just found the wallet. And then the Lord just nailed me right there, split second. And he said, 50 is the number of the Holy Spirit. It was an earnest deposit of Schaubhut spirit that was imparted into Joe. And I'm like, over 20 years ago, when he was with, and it could be 25, no telling. Over 20 years ago, Joe was traveling around with Schaubhut. Schaubhut walks up to him, gives him $50. Little did he know that that was a time in his life that Schaubhut spirit, it came directly from Schaubhut to him. It made a deposit into him, an earnest deposit that he had put away that's now being manifested. For the first time in my life, I knew why Joe always talked about Schaubhut. Because my mom imparted into me her spirit. I imparted it into my brother. That's why, you know, and it gets into a long story with this, you know, this gold chain with Jesus. Gold thing my dad made, had diamonds all in it. My daddy designed it, had given it to my mom, but she felt it was too big, so my daddy always wore it. My daddy made it for my mom, but my dad always wore it because my mom thought it was too big. One day I was at a church, and I walked in, and Pete and Jason were getting ready to play, and I'm walking up the aisle in this church. They was out at another church. And the Lord said, take the chain off that's on your neck and give it to your brother. It was an impartation. If you hear my brother, you hear me. It's all coming. That's what people tell me all the time. Because the spirit that was in me was imparted into my brother. Now, all of this is coming down right now. God is showing something. And it all is going to tie into this lampstand and other things as to what it is. But there's an impartation of the Spirit. Now, I want to say this because there was something the Lord had spoke to me when I was at, you know, Brother Seymour's house. that here's a man 86 years old, and he's talking about the tabernacle and all of this stuff, and I'm sitting there, I understand everything he's talking about, the patterns, the details, the, you know, and little do I know at that moment, God tells me to write everything down. I'm thinking Brother Seymour is, you know, he's looking at this guy, Paul, Brother Paul. And I'm thinking there's an impartation that because Paul's wanting to build a church. Remember that?
Yeah.
That's what it's about right now. And I'm thinking that, you know, Paul, you need to receive this so because he's wanting to build a church, and he does. But he needs to build, you know, so you can get an impartation from Brother Seymour. So when I'm talking to Joe on the way home, and Joe tells me that, I'm like, oh my God. Do you know when I picked up, this is between you and me. You remember when, you remember our conversation that we had? No, over there by your house. We was working, I called you and my brother. And I told you something I felt in my spirit. Remember? Anyway, I'll tell you in a minute. Check this out. The 2537 is all over the place. I go to Joe's.
Oh, when we were working?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I go by Joe's. I walk in this room, 2537. I walk in there. I got the black and red shirt on I had when I went to see Brother Seymour. Joe, as soon as I walk in the door, Joe says, I got that identical shirt. He said, I know where you got it from. You got it from Walmart. You paid $8 for it. Yeah. I look on his bed. His robe was the same color shirt that I had on first before I went to Seymour, but I took it off because it was wrinkled and put on the other shirt. They right there in the room. When we go to leave, the only clothes that Madge brings for Joe is the very shirt. Takes it out, pulls the tags off of it, puts it on Joe. The lady that brings the wheelchair, she said, y'all wearing the same shirt. Your name's Joe, his name is Joe.
Wow.
We take a picture together, brother. So.
And then he put his jacket on.
Then he put his jacket on, is identical to the shirt. Identical. Y'all know Joe Pesci. That's Joe too, right? Identical. So, you know, God is saying something right now. Yeah, I'm telling you, and this needs to be done. This is more today, more for information to let you know where it is that God has taken us. He is setting us up right now for something great, his church, okay? So when we go down the road and Joe says that to me, instantly, when he said $50, 50 is the number of the Holy Spirit, there was an impartation, all of a sudden I was back at Brother Seymour's, looking at Brother Seymour talking to Paul. But from there, I remember that as we was walking from the lampstand, which is symbolic to the Spirit, Paul looks at me and says, you see that house right there next to Brother Seymour? That was his son's house. His son passed away. I helped build it. That's what I just instantly. Now I want to tell you something. And Brother Joe, I want you to think about this because it's something you really need to pray about. I know the importance of the impartation of the Holy Spirit. Not only the Holy Spirit, but the gift that God has bestowed in us. When my daddy was dying, my daddy, the first time he thought he was about to die in a hospital, could barely talk, tried to give me the impartation of the rights of a firstborn son, and he was unable because he just couldn't get it out. But I knew what was happening. When we got home and hospice was there, he was about to pass. All of a sudden, my daddy went from being sick and couldn't even hardly talk to up like that. Bump. He woke up like everything was like my daddy. He said, "Everybody gather up around the bed." Remember? We all gathered up around the bed. He looked at my Uncle Leroy, told him he was his best friend.
Yeah.
And from there, he just started to cry. And he looked at me and he said, "Son," and I don't mean this in any way to you, Jason, but he's my firstborn. I knew right there that my dad was giving me an impartation of the rights of a firstborn son. He was on his deathbed. I never forgot it because it was so profound. And when my dad died, I took that chain that he had on around his neck that was made for my mom, that had Jesus on it with 39 diamonds in it, or 37, I'm not sure. I got to count them again. And I put it around my neck. It didn't have anything to do really with my dad. It had to do with the impartation of the Spirit of what it meant to me.
Amen.
Because it was made for my mom, but my dad had it because my mom imparted it to my dad, and it was mine. So when I got it, I mean, my wife will tell you how many times I cried.
Well, then you sold it.
And then the Lord told me, give it away. I sold it. And this gets into another thing, to make her wedding ring. And it came back to me. The jeweler wouldn't sell it, wouldn't melt it down. Called my wife and talked to my wife over it. And they wound up, she went behind my back and rounded up money and bought it back from the jeweler. And it came back to me. The second time, I'm walking in a church and the Lord said, give it to your brother. Because you imparted your spirit that was in you and him. I couldn't tell you what it, I knew I had to do it. And because God said it, I done it. And I wanted to do it. But I never felt the same again, as far as, don't get me wrong.
Killed you to do it.
I sat down 4 weeks ago, before all of this began, at the table we was talking about that chain. They tried to get me a chain with the Ark of the Covenant on it. They made me. They got me all kind of different things that I hung around my neck. They got me a chain with Yeshua on it, hanging around my neck. And it just, nothing was like that, you know. And it didn't have anything to do. It was the spirit that was tied and what it meant to that piece. So, you know, I'm telling my wife everything that's happening and what's going down. And this is absolutely amazing how God works. We've been married now 28 years. 28 years. 3 years ago, my 25th wedding anniversary, I wanted to have something made for my wife because God was speaking to me about his spirit, the lampstand. Because it represented the church. So I went to this jeweler and had this lampstand designed and made for my wife to give it to her on our 25th wedding anniversary. But I wanted the lampstand, I had the lampstand made, designed, but also the center is the shamash, the servant. And underneath the last branch that came down was I made a cross. So I wanted the cross to be in the lampstand. So the cross comes out. And it's got Yeshua written right down the center of it, which means salvation. And on the other side of the lampstand, it's got Promise and Joseph 25. While I'm talking to my wife in the upper room of my house, I'm explaining all this to her. She had just put that chain back on her neck. The lampstand I had made that represented the church. Okay.
I put it back on my neck for the first service here for Hanukkah. That's when I put it on.
She put it on her neck for the first service here on Hanukkah. That's the one I had made. All of a sudden, my eyes fell around her neck and I saw it. And the minute I saw it, she said, "You made this for me." But she felt it was too big.
No, I said maybe.
No, she said.
I didn't say that. I do think it's too big. But
yeah, you did.
I did. But I said, as you were telling me that, I said, I picked it up and I said, maybe I'm not supposed to be wearing this. I think you're supposed to be wearing this.
So for the first time,
she already felt it in the spirit, so it was confirmation.
It was a confirmation. The lampstand that I had made with the number 25 on it, with all the stuff going on right now. It's half of 50, but anyway, it's time. So it's by no coincidence all of these things are going down. In the church, you know, sign with the lampstand and all this. But let me tell you what's really crazy about all of this. It goes even further. I get a phone call from Holly, and what Holly wants to tell me about is some dreams. And you know, she said, this is crazy because, you know, John had a dream. You know, I just told John and Holly that there's a big change in some things that has happened to them in their life that I see that's unbelievable, that's very believable, but God doing a huge thing. But because, all you know, I started carving these bears, John has a dream about bears. Holly wants to find out what's going on about the bears. She goes in the Bible and looks up, goes straight to Elisha, where Elisha received Elijah's mantle.
Wow.
2 Kings 2:7.
Wow.
The prophet stood and watched him cross over the Jordan.
2 Kings chapter 2, the 50 prophets. 50, that's right. The 50 prophets watched Elijah and Elisha cross the Jordan. The 50 prophets didn't go because they were afraid the fire would get them. Remember I told you it was Pentecost and all of this. And two she-bears came out and devoured the 42 children. That represents the end time and the 42 months that they're going to be devoured by the Russian bear and all of this kind of stuff. But it all goes back to where Holly is led to. It's a mantle, right? Then she just tells me this morning that Elaine calls her up and says, man, this piece I really want to buy, you know, it's X amount of dollars. You know, what do you think? How much was it?
It was $169.
That's the Maccabean time. Watch this. So she shows me this dresser, a place you deposit. It's a jewelry box. Elaine calls her up, tells her about this jewelry box she wants to buy. And in this jewelry box, what do you think? Do you think I should get it or not? And so Holly goes and looks at it.
It was a shop within a shop, dude.
It was a shop.
Within a shop.
So she goes and looks at the jewelry box, wants to find out it's the name of it, and the name of it is what?
The Painted Mantle.
It's called the Painted Mantle.
Oh, wow.
Painted is something on the outside. It's a mantle. It's a place you deposit into your jewelry.
Wow.
She said, do you think I should get it? She's like, you better get it. But let me show you. There is something that's moving and happening right now in the spirit.
One other thing, she looked up the word bear too. It represents males.
Well, you were outside at my house yesterday morning. You and John, y'all were talking, y'all were carving bears. And I was on the phone with Elaine that whole time. And she was talking to me about the mantle and how, you know, when his mom died.
Hold on. Come up here, Holly. Come up here. Come on. Just because this is what the stuff they need to hear. Here. Watch what the Spirit's doing.
So, when his mom died, Elaine, his sister, a family member came up to her, and she was shaking, and it was obviously, like, not an appropriate time, and she said, "Elaine, I visibly saw your mom's mantle fall on you." And so a couple years, so through that process, the next couple years, Elaine was like the family mom. Everybody went to Elaine. Everybody called Elaine, just like you would a mom. It was Elaine. Well, a couple years ago, she said, "John, I really think that the time has come that I need to give you mom's mantle. Will you take it?" And he was like, "Of course." And so years passed by, and I always thought about, I don't really see that, you know, like we went through very, very difficult times. And it was in December where she had a breakdown one day, and she's like, "I'm worn. I feel like I'm trying to carry this mantle that's no longer mine. Like I'm trying to carry this responsibility of, you know, being there for everybody and being that person, and I don't, it feels forced." And so so then she ran into a lady like a week ago in a restaurant, and she was talking about, the lady came up to her and she said, "I saw your sister at church," and she came up and, you know, I prayed over her, and it was about the mantle, like that. Yeah, it was, she was saying that when she prayed over John's other sister, that she felt that his mom's mantle was trying to be passed on to her. But so Elaine called me. They were carving bears in the yard yesterday morning, and Elaine called, and we had like an hour and a half conversation about the mantle.
Before you came to shop.
Yeah, this was before the mantle piece. And so we talked about that, and just that transition and what it means. She was doing a lot of research on it because she's trying to make sense of what the other lady said about that mantle being passed down to the sister.
Now, I didn't talk anything to her about no mantle.
And I wasn't in service last Saturday. I was doing children's church. So I didn't.
Wow.
So I get off the phone, and Mal says, "Oh, I had this dream, you know. It was, I don't know how relevant it is, but it was about..." So he comes in, and I said, "Mal said she had a dream," and I was very weird with dreams last night. He said, "I had a dream, a bear was attacking me." So then I'm just like, okay.
That a bear was scaring everybody. Oh, scared. And I would walk up to the bear and just pet him, and it scared everybody.
Right.
So John kept the kids yesterday, so I could kind of refresh myself a little bit. And I was sitting outside of a store, and I was just like, I couldn't go in. I was just like, what is going on? And so I looked up the bear. Well, actually, before I looked this up, I looked up the mantle. Now, just trying to kind of piece together, because Elaine was like, look into it. I've been looking into it, and I'm just trying to get to the bottom of it. So I kind of did that, and it took me to Elijah, then how, you know, that whole process. Well, I was sitting outside the store, and I was like, what is the deal? Like, I just felt so riled up. And so I looked up the bear, and it took me right back to Elijah. And I was like, oh, my blood ran cold. And so I called him, and I told him everything. But in that process, my sister-in-law, you know, like he was saying, I said, "I'm not going to come over. I'm just moseying about." She said, "Well, go to this store and look at this piece." And so I did. And it was last night when I got on Facebook, and the lady had posted it for sale also on a Facebook site, and it said the painted mantle on it. But I was, when you were talking a while ago, I was thinking about this. The one thing that John got from his mom, everybody, you know, got jewelry and this and that, and he got her Bible. That was the one thing that he got, was her Bible. Well, the Bible broke into pieces. Like, it's broken, it's like literally like three or four chunks. No, but so around Christmas time, Elaine had called, and she said, "I really feel like you need to read this and that, and, you know, as a family thing." And he was like, "I don't know." Well, the one thing that we bought was her Bible. that's broken into these pieces. And then the lady that was talking to Elaine was saying, I feel like, well, she said she had a word that the man was trying to go to the other sister. And he said, well, maybe it's trying to go to both of us. I don't know if that's possible. But anyways, just
but you know, with all of that being said, if you look at, I got my mom's Bible too, Hadakes, it's, you know, it's definitely, it's gonna go to the firstborn son is where it's supposed to reside on. But whether, and others can get it as well, but I just, if we look at a whole as to what's happening, the confirmation of the Spirit, something is transferring. Notice the time. Remember, December 24th was when we set the church back up. The Maccabees put the house back in order. Why? So that the Spirit could reside. And I told you guys that God right now wants to build the pieces in you and me. Why? So the glory can descend on it. So this mantle could, you know, rest upon His church, His body. With all that being said, Brother Joe, I want you to think about something that's very important.
Amen.
Very important. You are carrying something that needs to be imparted before you pass. I don't know when you're going to pass or when you're going to go. Only God does.
That's right.
But what has been imparted to you from Shambach, you carrying it. And before you pass, you have to impart that into someone because it can't go home without you. Let me tell you why. With you. It can't go home with you. The Bible says, he that ascended is also the one that descended. And before he ascended, he gave gifts. Some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, for the perfecting of the church, for the edifying of body, for the work of the ministry. When I was riding in the car with you, the Lord spoke to me and brought me back to Brother Seymour. And I want to tell you, brother, I don't know how much time you have left. I'm going to tell you another thing. The shirt you wore was confirmation. God wanted me to tell you, you have been working on this church, His church, just like Pastor Seymour has, for a long time. The word that I just talked to John and my brother, I felt the Lord had put in my spirit that you don't have much more time. But before you go, God wants you to impart your spirit into someone. And I'm not saying it's me. You need to pray who it is that God wants you to impart your spirit. Moses had to impart his spirit. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and all of them. The connection between you and Brother Seymour and me, we all wore the same shirt. All of a sudden, the Lord hit me and spoke to me, brought me back to Brother Seymour, and I heard the words of Paul that was sitting there. And he said this, you look like him. You talk like him. You built the same things he built. And his son has died. I think the Lord brought me to Pastor Seymour's house. He's been working on the church for 65 years. 6 and 5 is 11. It's a transition number. God brought me there, had me write that man's eulogy last week, and I didn't even know it. You wasn't here to hear it. But there's no secrets with God, and God wanted me to reveal it to you. The reason the Lord brought me over there is I believe that God is now showing me that Pastor Seymour needs to impart his spirit. He's been building a church and working on a church for 65 years before he goes. It was at 4:30 in the morning the Lord spoke to me for about 3 hours. About 7:30 in the morning, I called up Brother Paul, told Brother Paul, you know, I need to be at Brother Seymour's funeral because the Lord has given me his eulogy. Not that I have to read it, but I need to be there. But really now, I really need to go see him and talk to him. Because it's important, before you leave, that God shows you the one that you need, the faith, the miracles that was deposited in you 25 years ago is now going to begin to come forth. And God right now is getting his house in order. You know what? And you might even be able to see it. But you might even be able to see what it is that God's going to do. I think he's going to let you see it.
Yeah.
And let me tell you something. This is a good thing because it's a work that you're going to be able to see that God has performed back then. You're going to see it again. But I really want you two guys. The Lord showed me before my dad passed and told me, Mama, you need to get your house in order. I wrote his eulogy 5 years before he died and told only my mom and my wife. So I don't know how much time. Seymour's 86, you 80. You might have another 6 years. You know, and no telling. But really, Brother Joe, I really want you seeking the Lord. And God is going to reveal it to you and show you, you know, who it is that what was deposited in you 25 years ago. You're going to know the time. You're going to know everything. That it's important that you don't pass away with that mantle that's on you, because you definitely have a mantle.
And plant it in good soil is what I receive.
And my mom said, and plant it in good soil. Right? That's good stuff. It's a hard word, but it's a good word. We all gonna go at one time. And he didn't tell me when with you. He didn't tell me with my dad.
Mm-mm.
You know, he didn't tell me with Brother Seymour, but he did tell me that, you know, but this is a time and a season of change that God is setting his church up for a deposit of his spirit and his mantle as to what's coming. My wife is in there working on something, and to get it ready for the children is a direct, you know, message to you and me that right now God is putting us in order, his church, so that there's going to be a deposit of the Spirit, of the Holy Spirit in the last days church that is going to be, it's going to go way beyond what was done in the beginning. Way beyond. The latter outpouring is the greater outpouring. That's what God is setting us up for right now and others. That's why she's talking about all of this starts going down in December. All of this starts happening in December. Everything starts coming together. And that's why it's, you know, it's not church as usual today. It's God letting us know and getting us right. Now I want to read a few things to you, right? Which is absolutely to show you. Let me tell you how deep this goes. And it goes with the jewelry box. Man, when this ministry began, almost 15 years ago, the Lord, I asked him, what do you want to call it? It was called Messiah Ministries, which means revealing the work of Yahweh's hands. All of a sudden, God starts 2 weeks ago, lays it on my heart to start carving, right? Just out of the blue, you know, I start carving. But you gotta carve according to the pattern, to the design. 2 weeks ago, I want to all of a sudden start learning how to carve. 2 weeks ago, I start telling my wife is online looking for patterns so that I can build a pattern. Follow the pattern and you can build. Right? These things are amazing how they happen. Brother Norwood Seymour, he's a carver. Right? He's a carver. Nor the wood and you'll see more. If I start carving the wood, you'll see more. and I'll start bringing out the all, so you get it, what it is. What is it about? It's about carving back or peeling back or, you know, revealing so that we can show you Jesus. That's what it's all about right now. It's all about revealing, not this bear.
No.
This is just a symbol of, hey, take notice to what I'm doing and what's going on around you, because God is revealing things right now. He's trying to show us something. I'm looking for patterns. Why all of a sudden do I want to carve and I'm looking for patterns? Because the building of the church right now, you can only build it according to the pattern that God has laid out. Build it. The word God spoke to me. Build it according to the pattern that I showed you. That's what God told me to do. All of a sudden, these words come back. The first dream I had, I was tearing apart. I was doing renovation work. I just told my wife, I'm thinking about going back into renovation work. All of a sudden, I'm going in business. This is going to be a business for me. But this business is going to be so that I can impart into people. Right? Crazy. I mean, even the testimony that happened yesterday. I called the bear head for somebody. Two people. My brother wanted me to do it. I go up there. I called this big old bear head. He brings it to the principal of the school in Poplarville. Meets his wife outside. I got something for your husband. She says, you don't have nothing for my husband. He said, yes, I do. She said, no, you don't. Jason said, yes, I do. I have something for your husband. She said, nobody gives my husband anything. Nobody likes him. He said, I have something for your husband. Jason said, come on with me. I'm going to show it to you. She said, I'm not coming. He said, I got something in the van for your husband. She said, no, you don't.
Oh, my God.
Yes, watch. Jason walks over there by the van, opens the van door, and carries a bear head about this big around, walks up and sets it on the ground. She turns around and looks and breaks down crying. She said, nobody ever gives my husband something. They don't like him. They don't give him nothing for Christmas. This is the principal of the school.
Wow.
They don't give him nothing for Christmas, nothing. They don't give him nothing for his birthday. They don't honor him for nothing. And you come in here to give him something? She called him up on the phone. Where you at? You know, he's walking out. Jason starts walking up to the man. His name's Carl. Jason walks up to him. First thing the man tells Jason is, you know what, Jason? I'm so glad you're here. I'm so glad you're who you are and what you do. I just want to tell you I appreciate you. First words out the man's mouth. Jason tells the man, you know what's funny? I'm here to tell you this. I was coming to tell you the same thing. The man looked at him. What? He said, in fact, I got something for you. He said, you got something for me? He said, you don't have anything. He said, come on. Walk to the truck, drop the tailgate. The guy broke down crying right there, wrapped his arms around him, and just cried. I had already prayed that God would use what I was doing. That man said, you know, nobody never gives me anything. He said, you know what I'm going to call that bear? I'm going to call him Jay. After you, Jason. You know what Jason's name means? Jesus.
Wow.
Jason is directly derived and straight from the name Jesus. That man broke down, started crying over the head of a bear because somebody cared. Man, all of these things, it's a pattern that God is showing us right now.
He told him when he dies, he wants
the man, listen, then he told Jason, when I die, I want this head next to me. I want you to sign it because it came from your heart.
Wow.
Man, if anybody will ever be able to talk to that man and minister to that man, it's going to be Jason.
That's right.
That man never received love from anybody, but at this time, through a bear head,
jeez,
God reached into a man's life to show him how much he loves him. Wow. And then the man's going to talk about dying. When I die, this is what's going to be beside me. You know what he said? When I die, Jesus is going to be right beside me.
Oh, hallelujah.
Woo! These wow. things just don't happen.
That's right. That's right.
This is the Lord's doing.
Yes, it is.
And it's great and mighty.
Yeah.
Man, there are some amazing things that God is doing right now.
Yeah.
When Paul was talking, I'm going back to my dreams. When Paul was talking, remember this was about a jewelry box? When the Lord gave me these three dreams about Messiah Ministries, and God said, I'm going to deposit things in you, and all the jewels and the treasures and all these things, He was showing me. You know, I've shared with you guys. That was the first dream, tearing out the wall, and all the jewelry fell down on the ground. And the Lord said, share it. Tell those that were behind you. My brother was behind me. My Lord. My brother and Jimmy was behind me. I had a dream about Jimmy last night. Golly. Jeez. And the Lord told me to choose that coffin. And I said, no. And He said, choose it. And when I wrapped my hands around that coffin on a chain, my God, son, all about jewelry. That's why that pulpit that's I put over there is called, made into a coffin. It looks like a casket because it represents the ark. The second dream was a jewelry box. A jewelry box where you put your jewelry. We got married. I made her jewelry, had a jewelry box made and put the ring in it. Remade the ring from over 22 years ago when we first got married. That was pawned off. I had it remade by a master craftsman to where she wears that ring again. The first dream, God gave me the revelation and understanding of it through the Tabernacle of Moses by Kevin Connor. The second dream was about a key that unlocks the treasure box. The Lord showed me in a dream, and the three big diamonds and the purple that rolled out, God was revealing His treasures to me. It wound up being a manifestation of the wedding ring. It was a three-tiered jewelry box, high with two low sides. There was a ring, diamond in the middle, two diamonds on either side. I even set the whole wedding up as a mystery. Built this stuff that's absolutely amazing that confirms it with the angel wings, and we had all this stuff. The third dream is fulfilled today. The first book that Kevin Connor wrote was my first dream. The second book that Kevin Connor wrote was my third dream, was my second dream. The Tabernacle of Moses. The Tabernacle of David. Second dream. The third dream, I was standing on a pulpit all the way at the end. There was two people on side of me. And the first guy on, I'm in a church, and the man on the end walks down there. How many people were there in the church? I said, baby. You remember? 600. How did I know that? Because there were 600 seats in the church. Anybody remember me saying that? 600. Very important. Standing on the pulpit, guy goes to the first one. Would you like to say something about Gabriel? No, 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 no. All the way down the line, I said, you know what? If he gets to me, I'm going to say something. Would you like to say something about Gabriel? Yes, this is my third dream, the third night. Go to the pulpit. Went up to the pulpit. The Lord downloads on me. I knew what I was going to say, but the music was loud. I asked the music to be turned down. It wasn't even turned down. I looked at everybody that was sitting in there. At that time, there was 600. That's probably only 16 maybe now. There were 600 people. And they were all looking at one another, except my mom and my dad were focused at me. They were looking dead at me. And I said, you know what? I'm a preach anyway. And as soon as I was about to say something, I forgot what I was going to say, and I woke up. That was the third dream. The third dream, I was in a church, and I was called to preach. I answered the call. Would you like to say something about Gabriel? Gabriel's name means man of God. That's Jesus Christ. At that time, I'm going back now, April of 1999, that's when it went down, that's when it happened. At that time, I didn't know anything about him. And I told this to you guys many times, these dreams. Today, I stand in a church now that God is rebuilding and remaking and reforming. And today, the third dream is fulfilled. Let me tell you how I know. Number one, when I was in the church, there were 600 people. I made a deposit of $600 on this building. This is the church. It represented the people, right? When I went to Brother Seymour, and I was sitting there having this, listening more than having a conversation, when I left there, I told Paul, God was trying to impart something into you. You really need to get that book, The Tabernacle of Moses, so you can understand God's pattern in building. He said, you know, I heard you say that about, you had the book, Kevin Connor, The Tabernacle of Moses, but I got the book by Kevin Connor, and it's called The New Testament Church.
Oh. Wow.
I opened the book and get the confirmation to the third dream.
Wow.
It's now. We're going back 18 years ago. God, 17, 18 years ago, God gave me three dreams, and the third one is being fulfilled today. The first two dreams was the Tabernacle of Moses and the Tabernacle of David. The two books become this one book, the New Testament Church. Build it according to the pattern I showed you.
Wow.
This is where we're going. When I opened this book and started reading, I was like, wow. I had to share it with my wife. Start telling her. And I read the foreword. I read chapter one, which was just the setting up of the book. Just what it was. Chapter two starts it. And this is what it says. Chapter two. There's no coincidence in God.
No.
Chapter 2. Build it according to the pattern.
Wow.
Man, God. And I'm going to tell you something. I walked in and I caught the last words that Charlene had said in there. The last couple of words you said right when you closed it. What was it?
Wow.
That's the last words I heard. That's the only words I heard her say when I came in there. The words that she had said was, the last words she told from her Bible study to the class was, we need to build the church according to the pattern that God has showed us. Or we're not a church at all. Or we're just doing this.
That's what you taught them.
We're just what? We're just a religious social club. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you what the first chapter is about. Really quick, fast. Before God sets up his church, he shakes everything that can be shaken to fall away so he can establish the true remnant.
Whoa. Wow.
Here it is. Here we are. There's some mighty things coming. Now, we're going to get into this next week. Amazing stuff.
Before you close, I give a testimony.
Okay. And we're about to end. But remember I told you guys this book I had laid by the lampstand when all this stuff was going on. Look at, watch this. Let's see. I got to watch this. Watch this. Here's.
Wow.
That's a new one that came in the mail.
Hey, I got, you got to get this, Carl. Look at this, Carl. Zoom it. The new edition. Look at this. The new edition of the Prophecy Club. If this is not God.
Wow.
And what's happening right now, I don't know. This is God.
Wow.
There's no coincidences in God. Brother, we're about to see some amazing things happen in God's church.
Wow.
I'm going to tell you another thing. I'm going to tell you when it's going to happen. Right now, God's got us in preparation between now and the springtime, April, for the Passover season. Right now, God is going to be getting us in order, His church.
Amen.
So that the Spirit is going to come in April and fall on us.
Hallelujah.
Because that's right. Because we're going to be in order, in unity, as a body is supposed to be.
In unity.
Doing what it is that God has called us to do.
Amen.
Here, watch this. All of these confirmations are for us, for you and me to know what it is that God is doing right now. Right? Look at this right here. I picked the book up because I just felt like I needed, I knew God wanted to speak some things to me in here. Only chapter that spoke to me was chapter 3. It's called The Shield of Israel. I'm going to read to you some quotes from here. Right? This book is from 1993. Right? Anyway. The menorah on the Arch of Titus was surely intended to represent the final destruction of the Jewish sovereignty and the dissolution of the Jewish nation. Yet anyone, this is Benjamin Netanyahu's direct quote, yet anyone in our own generation who has gazed up at it must feel that it represents the total opposite. For us, the lampstand, which has been adopted as the shield, the sign that we're to put outside, the shield for the state of Israel represents the revival.
Oh.
Amen.
Yeah. Woo!
Wow. Of the Jewish people and its return to its land. Wow. We just returned to Poplarville.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you know what the lady down the street, how God uses her so many times? She sees me carving bears. Remember I told you all the pieces that Brother Seymour made all the pieces out of? What he made them out of?
Poplar.
My neighbor comes down the street, says, I see you carving bears. You can come to my house and cut down that big poplar tree if you want it. It's a nuisance to me. Just come get it. Brother, let me tell you something. When God starts speaking and you have ears to hear, man, He will show you things amazing.
That book is the same. I just saw the name. That's the same people from the Prophecy Club, Joe.
Oh, Joe, this is the same person. The Prophecy Club, who wrote the book? J.R. Church and Gary Stearman. Here it is. It's established by two witnesses.
Wow.
Watch. So, the other thing my wife tells me, day before yesterday, you know, I was just looking into the temple and the Lord was showing me how God you know, call the master craftsmen, the carvers, to come and carve the cherubims in the doors and the pillars and all of that stuff. Time of carving. Right? While referring to the Roman conquest of Israel and the Arch of Titus, Mr. Netanyahu calls to attention to a major point. The menorah literally holds the hope of modern Israel. It reminds Jews of the temple and the priestly service.
That's right.
What did we say this church was being set up for? Service.
That's right. That's right.
But it represents particularly the Messiah, Benjamin Netanyahu, who they believe soon will come to unite the land and its people in the Messianic kingdom. This shield is formed by the temple menorah. This lampstand is formed by the temple menorah, designed after the one of the arch that was in Titus, that Titus took and carried to Rome. It is flanked on each side by a stylized olive branch, an olive branch, and an olive branch, making the nine branch Hanukkah, right?
Yeah.
Hanukkah. The lampstand that I had made has a branch on the right and the left, which is the cross, the arm of the cross. Across the base of the shield in Hebrew is written the word Israel. The two olive branches are rooted in that word. That's where they got the Hanukkah from. They got Israel. They got the two olive branches coming down, which represent the two anointed ones, or the two olive trees that are seen in the book of Revelations. Now I'm quoting directly from Benjamin Netanyahu. In particular, this is Benjamin Netanyahu. Zechariah's prophecy holds the promise that Zerubbabel, by the power of God's Spirit, would succeed in the work of restoring the temple.
Amen.
That's what's happening right now to the church. Remember, when I went and seen Brother Seymour, that bus that was torn apart and all, you know, that was a house, that family bus, it represented the church, I told you guys, that had been blasted and torn apart. But now, the Spirit of the Lord is rebuilding His house.
Yes.
And He says, and just as clearly the oil of the lamp is obvious as the symbol of the Holy Spirit, right? As the prophet inquires about the vision, he is specifically told, wow, I never knew this. Never knew this. We hear this quoted all the time. Not by might nor by power, but
by my Spirit.
You know where that quote is taken from? Directly from Zechariah chapter 4. That God's house would be built not by power nor by might, but by His Spirit.
Yes.
That's amazing.
Yep.
That word is coming true right now. It's happening.
Yes.
Still, Zechariah was puzzled by the picture. The angel had told him that Zerubbabel was ordained to finish the temple, but he wanted to know more about the outworking of God's power. The angel, for a further explanation, went like this in the dialogue. Then he answered and said unto him, what are these two olive trees on the right and the left of the candlestick, upon the left side and the right side thereof? And I answered again and said unto him, what be these two olive branches that are on, what be these two olive branches which through two golden pipes empty the golden oil out of themselves? Watch this. This is Zechariah chapter 4. And he answered me and said, Knowest thou not what these be? And I said, No, my Lord. Then said he, These are the two anointed ones that stand by the Lord of the whole earth. Thus the image of the two olive branches flanking the golden menorah on the right and the left becomes the symbol of the power to begin to rebuild the house of God. Wow. That is absolutely only God. And the last thing. Benjamin Netanyahu is right when he says that the shield of Israel represents the revival of the Jewish people and the return to his land. Everything that's happening right now. I just told John, when we was going up to Tennessee, we didn't know where we was headed to. First time, I told my wife, we're not going to make any reservations. I just feel like we need to go. On my way up there, I get a phone call from a man's wife, Elaine, who just died. Now check this out. No coincidence. Miss Elaine just passed away. The man who called me, what was his name? Brother, Mr. Mick.
Elaine's husband?
Yeah, yeah, Mickey. Right, Mr. Mickey. Mr. Mick calls me up. We headed up to Tennessee. His wife was in a hospital. I was in a hospital twice this week with my Uncle Mickey. One.
That's a testimony I want to give.
I'm going to let my mom give a testimony on that. We're going up there, and my Uncle Mickey tells me, Mr. Mickey tells me this. Brother, where are you headed to? I said, man, I'm going to Tennessee. I said, I'd like to come see Miss Elaine in Hattiesburg before I go. He said, look, she's in dialysis. You can't do it. But let me tell you something. I'm at the house working right now. He was working in the kitchen. Man, all of these little things start to come. I'm supposed to go remodel the kitchen right now. Watch this. He said, have you ever been to a place called Field of the Woods? Field of the Woods. I said, no. He said, well, you need to get off in Alabama. Exit 27. We're back in Poplarville. Yep. Off of exit 27. You're going to go into a place called Murphy. Murphy's Law, right? You talk about. In a little town called the name of that man's name, Duval. In a little town called Dovetown.
Come on.
He said, there is no signs. We look for signs, but if you're supposed to be there, you'll find it. I went into Murphy, Alabama. Went into this town called Dovetown. There's no signs.
Nowhere.
So I started stopping at gas stations, asking about this little place where you go up on the mountain and the Ten Commandments are written in the side of the mountain, and each of the commandment is 100 yards up and like 25 yards wide.
Wow.
And he said, oh, you're talking about the place Field of the Wood. Field of the Wood. Woods. I mean, we go up there. We pull in its gates, the front gates, big arched gates we're going in. It's got, when it was established, it was all about the establishment of the first church that came here. How crazy amazing is that? It was all about the Great Reformation of 1517. That's where the Lord spoke to me. The Reformation of 1517 is my address of my house, 1517. It was all about, which led into, in red, that was inscribed on the pillars, the revival the Azusa Street Revival, and Brother Seymour.
Which started in April
of 1907. I go see a brother, Brother Seymour, about a lampstand and all the stuff, building a church. Go up to this place where, you know, it's all about building a church, and, you know, I start reading these big stone pillars and all the stuff about God calling this man to start the church. An amazing place. A set time, an appointed time. It's now all coming back today, right now. It's all happening. Man, I'm going to tell you another thing. I'm like, Lord, are you calling me into business? Man, what's going on? John and Jason with their business. I go by Holly a little bit. Emma, she got a business going. I told the wife, man, I just feel like this is what God wants me to do. Start carving for the kingdom.
Right.
I'm going to carve, man, check this out. I'm going to carve bears. Big bears holding the King James Bible, 1611. Hey, every Baptist from here to Tennessee is going to be, I got to have one of them. They got a big old bear with 1611 King James bear holding the Bible. Like, I know one guy right down the street at North Spoon. He'd be the first one to buy it. That's going to be the first one I put in your shop, Ernest. I'm going to carve a big old bear holding a King James Bible. Because you know how they all about the 1611. It got to be the 1611 King James version of the Bible. And I'm down with it, right? So I'm going to carve a big bear with 1611. I could put $3,000 on that thing, which I won't. But any, they'd be like, ah, take it. But no, it's going to be, you know. In fact, it's going to be, let me tell you something. In fact, what? Bear witness. Wow. Wow. That's it.
What?
The name of the business. Wow. Let me tell you something.
I didn't think of that.
Let me tell you something, Rebecca. I told
the one that bore witness because she said she feels like the Lord might be putting her back into a new business too.
Yeah, Rebecca, listen to this.
I'm just waiting for Pete to tell me no.
Listen, I'm pulling in right here, and I just got in my spirit. I'm not even going to be able to keep up with it. I know it. Because I told my wife, you know what? I'm going to call it affordable carvings. They make bears this size for $250. Like this big. No way.
Painted,
you know,
and everything.
It's all painted and all of that. Now, this is just rough cut with a saw. I didn't do anything else to it. Just cut out with a skill, I mean, with a chainsaw, right? But I told my wife as I'm pulling in, I said, you know what? I know it's going to get so busy, we're going to need help. And I guarantee it, Rebecca would be the one that could help us in a heart. And you the one. And you the one that comes out and says, watch this, that bears witness. Listen, you know, God is, because you know what? It's all about carving out something. It's all about allowing God to carve off of you the things that doesn't belong in us.
Amen.
So we can become more.
See more.
So that we could see more
of Him.
See more of who He really is.
Yes.
That's what all of this is about. God is starting new businesses, new buildings. God is fixing to, the Bible says in the end, that God is going to take the money from the wicked and give it to who?
Amen.
To who? The righteous.
Yes.
Hey, what's the last thing you do to that bear? The last two things. Put the eyes of ringing burn.
That's right. That's right. You know, it's amazing because I just want you guys to be encouraged. We're going to get into the New Testament church. We're going to see really what it's supposed to look like. And in the process of seeing what it's supposed to look like, that's what God is calling us to be. So we all can come in unity and serve for one purpose. We can be a house that the glory of God can rest upon.
Amen.
And you guys, God has called you to be a part of it. That's why you're here. The forward, and I'm going to get into it next week. I'm going to read it to you. He shakes everything that can be shaken. God is shaking this church, son. Called us to do some crazy things. But you know what? Those who know and hold on, man, we are in for an amazing time.
Amen.
God is going to use this little place to do some amazing things.
Amen.
Right. And before I close, Mom, you want to come up here?
Yeah, I do.
Hold on. Hey, yeah, also, Brother Walt, I'm going to get Brother Walt to stand up. Brother Walt, pray and bless the offering for us, brother.
Appreciate it. Precious Father, we thank you for allowing us to assemble here together today to fellowship with one another and to fellowship with you, Father. We thank you for all your many blessings upon us, and we ask you, Father, to help us, not only this congregation, but all your children, Father, to be the church you designed us to be. Help us to put aside our petty squabbling and bickering among ourselves and to be what you designed us to be, Father. Help us to only uplift, edify, and encourage one another. Yeah. Help us to never belittle, berate, or put down one another. And thank you, Father, for the offering, and we ask you to bless the gift and the giver as well. And those that have not to give, bless them that they'll have to give next time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Give me a hug.
Amen.
Man, I'm so excited, guys.
Yeah. Amen.
You know, one thing I want to say is never underestimate the power of God. You know, never underestimate the power of prayer. That's what I wanted to say. Prayer. Prayer is so important. I had an old friend at my house this week, and one of her kids was into drugs, was into theft, and I'm telling you, this woman of God, she really prayed a whole lot for her kids, and he said that he was going to kill himself, and he drove his car off a bridge, and they took him out the water, and she got word before he died. The little Baptist preacher was able to talk to him and was able to share Christ with him, and he gave his life to the Lord right before he died. So God, we serve a faithful God. Well, I wanted to share about my brother. My brother lost his wife maybe a little over a year ago. And he never got better. He couldn't live under the pressure, the anxiety of it. I even went and spent a week there, and then later on another week there, and pastor went over there and shared the word. We were together and shared the word with him, and he started reading his Bible and everything, and anxiety just took him over, and I would talk to him, and he would say, Pat, I just don't have any reason to live. And I told him, I said, yes, you do. I said, you got your kids, you got your grandkids, and I know. He said, but I'm lonely, and I don't want nobody else, and I'm in this house by myself, and, you know, you got to get a friend, and, you know, just talking with them and stay in your word and all of that. Well, I got a phone call saying that he tried to kill himself. His son couldn't get him to answer the phone. Somebody told him that his truck was there, so he just felt he had to get over there. And when he got over there, he was unresponsive. There was no heartbeat, no pulse, nothing. And Mike started to cry and scream out for his dad, and he took his fists and he hit his dad's chest, and he hit his dad's chest the second time, and he hit his dad's chest the third time. And when he did, my brother coughed and yellow foam and started coming out of his mouth. They called 911, and they, you know, got him to the hospital. They put the the breathing machine in him, and so he got, you know, was breathing and everything, but his body was so full of medication. He actually took about 12 Xanax, and his wife's old medicine was stronger because they found out she had brain tumor, and his was stronger, and we don't know what was in that bottle, and he took all of that. And but God was so faithful. When they found him, my brother's hands were folded, you know, so he went out in prayer, you know, and he's alive, thank God. It took very, very long for him to come to. They didn't want nobody to wake him up, you know, and I got to talk to him a few minutes yesterday, and you know, I told him how much I loved him, and he told me he loved me, and you know, he said, I know I shouldn't have did what I did. I said, you know, brother, I said, you went out in prayer, you know, with your hands folded. And I said, God answered that prayer. I said, he wasn't going to let you go like that. Your son got there just in time to bring you back. I said, Rob and I was there, Joseph and I was there. And, you know, Joseph said that from here on, there's going to be great things for you. And he said, I hope so, Pat. And I said, how you feeling? He said, I feel a lot better. So I just want to give God praise for that. Thank you, Lord.
All right. All right, guys. God's good.
All the time.
And
every day.
Anybody want to say something before we close out? Yes, Joe. Here, I'm coming. Come on. I felt like somebody. Right. Come on.
Hallelujah is all I can say.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You know, you put me on the spot. I don't quite know where to start, but I guess start at the beginning.
Yeah.
What are you talking about? All of the stuff that's been poured into me for 25 years has been sitting there, and it hasn't been used. Sometimes I feel like blown up. And I mean, not that I'm frustrated, because God's got me here, he's got me under pastor. And you know, that's the thing. But before we begin, I just want to say one thing. Remember, you can't, when the Holy Ghost starts to move, he moves.
Yeah.
And nobody can do nothing about it. When he starts to do something, move out the way. Because that's what happens. You see signs and wonders,
yes.
Smoke, you know, all that kind of stuff. The Bible also says God accompanies the preaching of the word with signs following. Oh my God, I'm getting chill bumps right now. We need to have signs.
Yes.
I don't mean the exit sign, no smoking sign. I'm talking about signs in the church.
Yeah, we know where those signs are.
We know about that. Today, the people don't see no signs.
Yeah.
The church is, for the most part, I hate to say it, brother, is dead.
Yeah.
They play in church. They don't want to commit themselves. They don't want to spend time with God or learn anything from God. I feel blessed so much, so many times, and then I feel blessed to be here at this time. Like I say, I don't know much time I got left.
Hallelujah.
But I just feel that we're in a growing state, like he says. But hold on, because if God ever turns me loose, because I've been sitting right here, I have not moved, look out. Because if it comes out, it's going to come out. It's not going to be me, because I'm not that smart, not that educated. It's going to be the power that he has implanted in me.
Amen.
To give to you.
Amen.
See, I believe in signs and wonders.
Amen.
Old Slewfoot been trying to do a number on me. You can't kill me till the time's ready.
That's right.
But I tell you what, times ahead, as the times like this, it's never by many. It's always by few. You remember the story of Gideon? He had too many people. He said, prove them. Remember, prove?
Yeah.
They divided in half, and then half left again. Prove them again. They wound up with 300 people. It started with 10,000.
32,000.
What, 32,000?
32,000.
See that? I'm glad he knows all that stuff.
Okay.
But it was a big crowd. So look at this. I believe in Poplarville area, they got, well, I'm from originally from New Orleans, St. Bernard. I'm a Bernardian. In Mississippi, there's a church in every corner.
Yeah.
Where I come from, there's a ballroom in every corner.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's the truth. Am I right or wrong?
Right, right.
All right, so we're in a prime location. What I see here is religion.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to say it, religion. You start to talk to people about God and the things of God, and you see... Yeah. You mean they're not interested. They're not hungry for God.
Yeah.
One thing I thank God for is that when God touched me, there was a hunger for Him.
Yeah.
And a movement that He was doing and hasn't stopped ever since. I keep looking for that day, looking for that time when God will begin to do these things. I think God is getting us all ready.
Yes.
Every one of us has a gift.
Yeah.
Everybody has a gift.
Yeah.
And we're going to use those gifts. We're going to put them away, whatever it happens to be.
Amen.
Even if it's to give a cup of water to somebody that's thirsty.
Amen.
You understand? But I don't want to talk too much. Just want to let you know. But if He ever turns me loose, I'm telling you, watch out. Because I feel the anointing on my life right now. Since you said I don't have much time, I better get it over it while I can. I mean, I don't know. I'd rather go out like, you know, I'd rather go out and pray it than go out to some dead funeral home. You understand?
Right.
And also decided that when I finally pass, I saw something that's good. Imagine I talked about it. We're not going to have a funeral. We're going to have a going away party at Rocky and Carlos.
Come on!
That's right. That's right.
Rocky and Carlos.
That's right. Let me tell you something. Our friend was ours, right? His mother died. And we got an invitation in the mail. My mother died. It's going to have a such and such a date. If you can come, please let me know that you're coming. Well, let me tell you, the place was packed out. They had the best time we ever had. And that's the kind of stuff his mother wanted. You don't think she wanted people crying and carrying on? She wanted them to feed their faces with their good Rocky food. And we did.
My whole family worked at Rocky.
Well, there you go. So look, I'm telling you again, if I go, I'm going to have them cremated, put me in a box. I don't know what I'm going to do with the ashes. Maybe I'll spread them around or whatever, put a fertilizer. It don't really matter.
We'll use it as pepper.
Yeah, whatever.
So everybody gets some anointing.
Whatever. But now I have to, Madge has to sign on that deal too. I don't know if she is or not. But I just want to let you know, I think it's a wave of the future.
Yeah.
Why spend thousands of dollars in a funeral home of people moping and groaning with all their suits and ties on when somebody can come to Rockies and enjoy?
Are you buying?
Yes. Well, not me. Oh, yes. Whoever left is going to buy.
If you buy it, I'm coming.
Hey, maybe Tony's going to buy. Hey, now, maybe a new trend. Think about it, man. How much it costs to do a funeral, and then everybody eats a finger sandwich and drinks a little coffee. Man, to go to Rockies, man, I'm thinking all... Well, that's all right. That's okay. You can cash it back.
It's celebrating your life.
Well, that's true. I mean, look, all of us... That's a going home party.
But
that's what it is.
It's amazing. We in a restaurant. He's talking about a restaurant. I don't know about Rocky's. By the way, Robbie's is that.
Right here. That's right. Robbie's is right here. But listen, y'all want to think about it. Look, the cast is broken. In other words, when I say the cast of the mold is broken. Today he broke it.
Amen.
The challenge of all of us. He done gave us a peek of what God has been revealing to him. Now it's all we have to be spiritually in tuned enough to take advantage of it.
Amen.
Not to let it die out.
Amen.
Not to let it say, well, I don't know about all that. God wants real people.
Amen.
Unfortunately, I spent a lot of time in a Pentecostal church, and I'm not knocking a Pentecostal church. But what I found out was years and years dealing with those people, they were superficial. It was all soulish, not in the spirit. In other words, it was all for front. Look at me. Look what I can do. But I see that God uses the people. I'm looking at them. Man, look, there's a sweetheart if I've ever seen one person. I was just telling her what I was going through. Before I knew it, she laid hands on me, getting to pray for me.
Yeah.
And there's a woman that's called, I believe, God. to have that kind of spirit impartation on somebody like you, that don't hesitate to know the power that God has bestowed upon you in your heart, in your spirit, that you want to see people delivered and healed. That's a calling, dear.
Amen.
That's a calling. Everybody can't do that. Everybody can't move like that. Not to hesitate to pray for God to deliver those people, whatever the thing is, that's a calling.
Amen.
And I want to see 100 people like her.
Amen.
I want to see every one of y'all have the same motive, that when you see there's a need, you move on and take care of that need,
right,
whatever it is. Look, people have been bringing me food. Man, I'm telling you, I'm well taken care of. Red beans and rice, Holly, by the way, that's the best beans I've had in a long time. You understand?
I want some.
But they were good. I mean, I had a lot of good stuff that's been brought to me. Everybody's been taken care of. I feel like today is my best first day back. Really, it is. Because from the beginning of the year, today is the 15th, 13th, whatever it is. Man, I've been like a prisoner. I actually have been like a prisoner. I can't do nothing. I can't go nowhere, go in here, punching holes in me. Man, if you've seen what the doctor's done, I think I'm going to put it on Facebook.
Joe, don't put it on Facebook, Joe. Hey, let me say that I go in a room. I walk in a room. He's sitting there in a chair. He raised up a thing. He says, "Look at this. I think I'm gonna put this on Facebook." I'm like, "Oh my Lord." Hey, you know, I want to tell you something. And all, man, that's amazing stuff. If we look at what the Spirit was saying today, and this is what it is, you know, this is not your end, you know, but it's definitely something the Lord wanted to speak to you, and I'm not recanting on the words that I said, because they were directly from the Spirit, to think about, you know, who you're going to impart your gift into before it's time, and you'll have plenty of time to know and all of this stuff. But you know, what you just said just now, for the first time in your life, you feel like you're back. If you listen to what was being talked about today with the church, what my mom just said, what Joe said, this is all about resurrection.
Yeah.
The church being revived. My Uncle Mickey being revived.
Yeah.
Joe being revived. The lampstand, revival.
Yes.
Man, it's amazing stuff.
Yes.
Right? Putting oxygen to us. That's the Spirit. Uncle Mickey came back as soon as they put the oxygen. That's what's happened. God is putting his oxygen, the breath, the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh on his church. And let me tell you something. It was and I'm going to talk about it next week, but from it in the first month, on the first day, is when Moses raised up the tabernacle and the glory of the Lord descended on it in the springtime. God right now is getting us together, getting us in order to pour something on us that's going to be absolutely amazing. You guys be blessed. Love y'all.
You know what? We forgot the best part at the hospital. One of the sons said, "You know, that's just not my daddy." We telling him, "Watch TV." He said, "No, I don't want to watch TV no more. It's nothing but filth on there." He said, "What?" The stepson said, "I gave him a call, and you know, I curse, you know." And he told me, "Son, don't use that language." He said, "What's wrong with that man?" But we were seeing the fruits of him reading his Bible.
Right.
So we was excited.
Yes, I'm gonna tell you.
Yeah.
You know, I was I didn't want to go to where we had to go to this morning. I was like, okay, we're going to go sit in another boring class. Well, I found out why we went. They had a guy there. Let me tell you. His name is Solo. He was actually ministering at the old jail here years ago when you was a jailer. And while we were in there, I pulled my guitar out and I put it down. Well, he noticed this and he came to us. Well, he invited the Citadel Church into a state prison for us to go into.
Wow.
And Angie. Yeah, let me tell you something. When this guy spoke, when he spoke, it was like real. I don't know anything about whatever revelation he has about the Word of God and all of this and what everything means, but what come out of his mouth was only Christ. And he even called himself a dirtbag. And Pete and I turned around and looked. We looked at him. I'm like, okay,
it's about the Spirit.
He's in the mirror, dude. This man is real. And then when he came up to us, he gave us invitation. Application to fill out for Pete and I to go to the state prison.
Wow.
Bro, I need my pastor
I don't know about that.
To sign us off to approve that we can do that.
Wow.
You know, I'm going to do it now then. Let me do it now.
Wow.
Pete, can you show me what you made?
Wow! I used to go to Angola, now to see my kids going to state prison.
Hey, let me tell you something. You remember I told you guys about the Spirit and the impartation of the Spirit? My mom, when she was young, she used to go to the prison. And then I started going to the prison. Angola. And now, here it is, he's going to Rankin County, which is the state prison with Pete, and just...
No, it's Angie, Louisiana, Rayburn.
Oh, Angie, Louisiana, gotcha. So these are open doors. You see God, what you know, what God's doing, and this is good stuff. I love you guys. Be blessed, and see you soon.